we're going, as inequality grows and as we see this fighting go on, are we going to see more violence? I looked to Sunday and I asked that question. As inequality grows, we're going to see more violence. That's why I've asked Michael Shank, Vice President of the Institute for Economics and Peace, economicsandpeace.org, the website. Michael, thanks for taking time for me.
Thanks for having me.
You know, I look at this mass inequality, and you know, with the shooting on Sunday and a lot of the insanity that we're seeing going on, I'm only of the assumption that it's only going to continue as this inequality gets worse.
I think that's right. We're dealing with record rates of both poverty and income inequality. One out of every two Americans in poverty or low income. We have the highest income inequality since the Great Depression, and with that coming a whole host of social and health problems, some of which you've mentioned in terms of homicide, violent crime, obesity, mental illness, lack of social mobility, high infant mortality, things like that. So in terms of projecting or forecasting into the future, will we see more of it? Well, we know the strong correlations exist between poverty, inequality, and violence. So yeah, I think that's a fairly safe prediction.
And you know, the thing is, you know, I look at just yesterday we were talking about the Mars rover landing. And, you know, the $2.5 billion to do what just incredibly amazing to me. And, you know, you look at the money that we spent over in the sandbox. We could have done that landing almost 1500 times. And it tells me that we're misprioritizing our spending. We could end this income inequality. We could end poverty. We could feed every child. I guess we just choose not to.
We choose not to. That's exactly right. We spend $10 billion each month at war with Afghanistan. You know, if we eradicated violence in the U.S., we'd save $460 billion a year. And yet, with sequestration conversations in Congress, you know, you've got members of Congress, both in the Senate and the House, both Republican and Democrat, fighting to protect their defense industries from cuts. So we're not spending money on education, on health, because we know more peaceful states, more peaceful cities have higher rates of education, higher rates of health, lower poverty and lower income inequality. So yeah, it is a matter of choice. We're just choosing not to.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, here's the thing that bothers me is, you know, ending violence isn't really profitable for the handfuls. You know, the people who own our prisons and the people who own the military industrial complex. Sorry, peace isn't a good thing.
Right, and what Congress doesn't get, because you're right, they're serving various industries, whether it's the prison industry or the military industrial complex. What they don't get is that is violence is bad for the economy in terms of economic productivity. With each homicide, taxpayers are paying initial costs are $1.3 million, and that's just in medical costs, court costs, police costs. But there's a long-term impact, obviously, because that person is no longer in the workforce. So you're suffering in terms of economic productivity. So what we try to do at the Institute for Economics and Peace and with our various peace indices is put a cost on violence and really show policymakers what we're losing currently. And it's a pretty big price tag, pretty hefty price tag.
Yeah, but how do you go about changing the system? And this is kind of where my focus has been. How do we change the direction we're going? How do we close that gulf between those who have so much and those who, well, in the richest country in the world are going to bed hungry?
Well, business and policymakers should care whether or not consumers, everyday consumers in America, can afford to buy anything. What we know from more peaceful states, more peaceful cities, is that you have higher education, like I said, higher health, lower poverty, lower income inequality, which means they can afford more. You have higher labor participation rates. You have better access to basic services. And you have higher social capital. That it is extreme value in terms of people are able to shop more. They'll be able to buy more. They're out in the streets. They're you know, frequenting various shops, et cetera. That's what we're trying to show. You know, Congress has been pretty quiet in the wake of Wisconsin, in the wake of Colorado, in the wake of Tucson, largely because the NRA has been contributing pretty hefty amounts of money in terms, yep, of, you know, the various millions. However, that really pales in comparison in terms of preventing violence in the long run, what that would do to our economy. So, you know, some of our work also looks at the spirit level, which is this great book by two UK economists, Richard Wilkinson and Kate Pickett, that show U.S., unsurprisingly, highest income inequality in the rich world. And with that, the whole host of social and health problems that I mentioned. It's a great chart in some of their work, if folks want to check it out, in terms of relating to policymakers and saying, look at what this inequality is costing us in terms of we have more obese people, we have more people on various drug addictions and alcohol addictions. You know, if we just had a better healthcare system that paid for preventive services in dealing with mental health and mental illness, the shooters in Tucson, Colorado, and Wisconsin would have gotten the treatment they needed in advance before they resorted to something like this. All of them dealt with mental illness, whether it's PTSD or schizophrenia. So we need better mental health preparedness, and a better health insurance system would cover that.
Yeah, I'm absolutely in agreement. In fact, a friend of mine has, you know, just told my wife last night that it's been 3 or 4 days since he's had his antidepressants because he can't afford to buy them. And, you know, yeah. I'm sorry, that is not good. And I don't think he's violent. I don't know. But, you know, here's the thing. That's not good for society.
Absolutely not good for society. And, you know, you've talked in previous shows about the tendency of America to other, to create another. And that makes it very easy for us to increase defense spending to kill or eviscerate the other, whether it's overseas or even internally. So we've got to focus on that, and we've got to focus on gun control. I mean, you had some devastating stats from the Brady campaign in terms of 61 mass shootings since Tucson, 100 school shootings since Columbine. The fact that we still have 100,000 firearm injuries, 30,000 of which result in death in this free country is pretty problematic, because we're not attending to safety and security issues, again, which ultimately cost our society.
But Michael, it's not the gun who kills people. It's people.
Right.
I mean, the gun helps.
Actually, the analogy that I've made in some of my articles since both events in Colorado and Wisconsin is that, you know, there are other weapons in society. An automobile is a weapon, can be used as a weapon, but we have better regulation on automobiles in terms of, do you want to drive an automobile? Do you want to buy one? Do you want to register one? Do you want to insure one? We don't have any of that on guns. We need to.
But here's the question. I mean, the gun and the car and all that are lethal weapons. But what about outsourcing jobs? What about economic destruction that we've seen for the last 30 years as we deindustrialize and take away the opportunity of working class people to support their family? And in essence, well, killing them early.
That's exactly right. In the last 30, 40 years, based on labor policy, tax policy, and trade policy, we've eviscerated our middle class. You know, minimum wage hasn't grown in the last 4 years. It's actually lower now than it was in 1968. We've outsourced a lot of jobs, as you mentioned, capital gains tax really opening up the gap between the rich and the poor. The beauty of a true Make It in America strategy is that it would lift up the poor Americans, you know, those living in poverty, 50 million living in poverty, 100 million living in low income. They need jobs. We need to make it in America. And also, you know, boosting the minimum wage. Few in Congress are really courageously and bravely talking about that. We need to raise the minimum wage. We need to make tax policy fair, which would address some of the capital gains taxes and corporate loopholes. Certainly, you know, I've talked about this before with GE and Pepco in the last year paying negative tax rates of 40 to 50%. This is not a fair tax policy, and so we need to revamp a lot of that.
Now, I'm glad you brought that up, because, you know, I rail on that a lot. You know, we keep hearing we need to give, you know, we've got the highest taxes in the world for our poor businesses. Highest, we paid those two companies to be here. We paid them. How do I get employees that are going to pay me to work for me?
Well, the irony is that, you know, Jeff Immelt, who at GE runs the President's Council on Economic Competitiveness, one is saying he won't choose who he's going to vote for. So he's not being explicit about that, despite the fact that the president put him on the Council of Economic Competitiveness. But he's also admitted in the last year or two that he primarily outsources most of his jobs. So here's a man who's running the president's Council of Economic Competitiveness to look at a Make It in America strategy. And even he is being quite, you know, brazen about the fact that he outsources most of his jobs. So it's up to Congress to really force or, you know, create regulation for business and incentivize business to make it here on our shores.
Yeah, but here's the thing, and you brought it up a moment earlier, that, you know, what we're doing is we're demonizing and dehumanizing groups of people. So, you know, it doesn't surprise me that, you know, on Sunday, which, you know, I was in a place where when the news was on, they go, well, it's just those Muslims. And I'm going, they're not Muslims. Stop it. But it's that this concept of the other. It's their fault. It's never, you know, anybody above us. It's always somebody behind us that's pulling us down.
Well, if I could address that for a second, because you're right, post-shooting at the Sikh temple, everyone was like, they're not Muslims, despite how you might prejudice them based on their kind of external look. And then a day later, a mosque gets torched in Missouri, and certainly Muslims facing a lot of discrimination in this country. So the othering is pretty widespread. It happens to LGBT communities, happens to Latino immigrants. We do it whenever we need to bolster usually a harmful policy and a violent policy. And we do it pretty categorically.
You know, I have a friend who, you know, he just, you know, he pines for the wonderful days of the 50s and 60s because we, you know, we lived in harmony and everybody was happy and Norman Rockwell paintings and all of that. And, you know, I go back to, you know, we were kind of an equal society back then. I mean, there were poor people, but there weren't an awful lot of very wealthy people. Right now, I've said sarcastically that I take some national pride in knowing that we have the largest number of billionaires in the history of civilization. And some pride, granted, you know, all those poor people don't really matter. We've got the billionaire class, so that's a measure of pride, right?
Well, and you're right about the 50s in terms of, you know, the less of a gap between the rich and the poor. But here is the devastating part of that American dream thinking that, you know, you can just go from rags to riches and work your way up and become a billionaire if you want, is that we have the lowest social mobility in the rich world, according to the OECD. And so there's actual major fallacy in that American dream concept. You can't work your way up as much as policymakers profess or even kind of Hollywood claims, or certainly some of the presidential candidates have professed. So there's a real fallacy in that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and the thing is, you know, going back to this violence thing, I remember as a kid, you know, I grew up in a housing project on the west side of Cleveland, and violence was, you know, people were stealing from each other in the neighborhood because they were just trying to make ends meet. And my concern is that as this it gets harder and harder for people to put food on the table and harder for people to hold on to what they have, that we see more of this violence and we see more of this tragedy continue.
Yeah, I'm afraid to see and say the same. You know, if people have a job, they have an education, they have a family, they have a community that they trust, they're less inclined, and they have health insurance, they're less inclined to give all of that up and resort to violence. But when people are poor and unemployed, the likelihood that they have nothing to lose, nothing to risk, and are scrounging for a meal and kind of living day to day and don't even have clean water and clean sanitation. That's not the America we want. We've got to address that, both for the economy's sake and for humanity's sake.
Yeah, Michael, are you concerned with the destruction of the safety net that we're seeing? We've seen for the last 30 years. I mean, there was the welfare queen and all of these mythical figures that the right continues to throw out to get us to say, well, we need to destroy welfare programs. We need to make sure that the wealthy don't pay taxes. Are you concerned that the complete evisceration of the safety net?
Without question. I've written on this a couple times. When Wisconsin, Ohio, and Florida state legislatures, Republican, were cutting social policies and social budgets around education and health, because they're already getting lower on our peace index, meaning they're getting more violent. Because we look at, just a quick thing on our data, we look at violent crime, homicide, police per capita, incarceration, and availability of small arms and small weapons. All three states tilting down on our index, getting more violent. And the proclivity of the state legislatures to cut there only increases the likelihood that they'll see more violence and that will cost their state budgets more in the long run. So, yeah, you know, this whole debate between public and private, small government, if we go lean on government, we have to make sure the private sector is going to pick up the ball where public left off. And I don't think they're either being ready to do that or inclined to do that. And so as a result, a lot of people are going to fall through the cracks, and this one out of two Americans living in poverty or low income is indicative of the fact that a lot of people, half our country, is falling through the cracks.
Yeah, I guess the question I have with your assessment of private corporations having to take over where the public was left out, is there a profit in it? Because that's the only way they're going to do it, and I think people have to understand in this free market economy that we claim to so love, capitalist system, things are only done for a profit.
No, that's exactly right. I mean, and there's also a fallacy in the free market, given how much we subsidize these corporations. But yeah, are they going to be inclined to do it? Well, if they see the American person and the American people as potential consumers, they should know long term that there's profit. But you're right. Initially, they're not going to be inclined. So as the public drops some of these critical safety net programs and lean their budgets, go austerity across the board, I think we're only going to see more people fall through the cracks and higher rates of violence as a result.
Last line of questioning I got for you. You know, here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, our governor gave $1.7 billion away to Shell Corporation to build this cracker plant. He's given away hundreds of millions of dollars in tax subsidies to big corporations at a time where he's cut $1 billion each of the last 2 years from public education. He completely eliminated the general assistance budget that's, you know, basically kicked 70,000 of the most vulnerable Pennsylvanians to the curb. This shift in priority of what helps folks at the bottom to fattening those at the top seems like it's going to continue. Is this the path towards this solving this inequality problem?
Well, certainly what the Pennsylvania governor is doing, and my mother and her husband live in Lititz, Pennsylvania, so I want to give a shout out to them because Pennsylvania is near and dear to my heart because of that reason. We know from our work and our data, which we get from the most credible sources from the Economist Intelligence Unit to the UN, to the World Bank, you name it, that the strongest correlation exists in terms of more peaceful states if they have a higher rate of high school graduation, higher educational opportunities, and that their educational performance, is strong. What I've heard stories coming out of Pennsylvania where teachers and parents are raising money just to keep their schools alive shows that the lack of prioritization of both education and economic opportunity in the state of Pennsylvania puts it in a really dangerous position long term, both in terms of violence but also competitiveness.
Yeah, well, and again, you know, I worry about the future of my children. And as I see the defunding of education, I see what we've done to our infrastructure the last 30 years is what we're going to be doing to our education system for the next 30 years. And it's not a good scenario. Michael Shank, I appreciate the time. Vice President of the Institute for Economics and Peace, economicsandpeace.org, the website. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Rick.
Let's take a quick break. Back with your thoughts. 1-888-520-RICK. 1-888-520-7425. This is The Rick Smith Show. Cars with guitars and drummers go.